Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jagannaut, and today I want to talk to you about literature. Yes, it's another literature video. Occasionally I do those because it's actually the main thing that I do in life. It's my job. Basically, I write articles and do research about various topics regarding to, related to literature, culture. It's a broad sort of thing, but basically it boils down to I write things about books, and of course you can throw in video games and movies and stuff like that in there as well, because that's what modern literary arts and science has evolved into. It now pretty much fully includes all those things as well, in small part, I would argue, due to my efforts as well. I don't mean on a global level, but a local level. However, you know, when all universities locally start doing it, it becomes a global thing and so on and so forth. Not to bore you too much with my day job, but that's essentially what I do, and occasionally it bleeds over into YouTube, where I talk about certain things that I find particularly interesting, fascinating, or, otherwise noteworthy. And so today, ladies and gentlemen, is such a day where I want to talk to you about something that I found quite unusual, peculiar, and I've done a heck of a lot of research about, I've done a lot of research specifically as to whether other people have covered this, and how extensively has something like this been covered in the past. And, well, the TLDR of it is it hasn't really. People just sort of tend to gloss over this, and it isn't really a big point in science. And so, I mean, with no further ado, although you could probably guess what the video is going to be about from the title, but with no further ado, let's talk about literature being prophetic and shaping the future, or shaping the future. We'll get into it in a little bit. But for now, let me tell you what actually sparked my interest in this topic, in a manner of speaking. And it's actually two things. First is a book that I read just a couple of days ago called The Neuromancer. It's pretty much the capital, most important, biggest, greatest science fiction thing ever when it comes to cyberpunk, right? It's the book that started the whole cyberpunk movement, that quote-unquote lit the fuse of the cyberpunk movement. In fact, I have the book right next to me right now. Now let me read the New York Times sort of a little quote here from the New York Times about the book. So it says, "A masterpiece that moves faster than the speed of thought and is chilling in its implications." Of course, this is meant to sort of sell you the book, but yeah. So it's written by William Gibson, and again, just reading off the back of the book here, and let me tell you what it says. William Gibson revolutionized science fiction in his 1984. Remember, it's written in 1984. This is kind of the whole point of the video, this and another book that I want to talk about. Debut novel, The Neuromancer. The writer who gave us The Matrix and coined the term cyberspace produced a first novel that won the Hugo Nebula Philip K. Dick Awards and lit the fuse of the cyberpunk movement. More than three decades later, Gibson's text is as stylish as ever. His noir narrative still glitters like chrome in the shadows, and his depictions of the rise and abuse of corporate power, looking more precedent every day, part thriller, part warning, so on and so forth. Winner of the Hugo Nebula and Philip K. Dick Awards. The Observer even called him the Raymond Chandler of science fiction, although, honestly, in my modern... I apologize, I just woke up like 5 minutes ago, well, 10 minutes ago, and now I'm stuttering and stumbling over some words. In my modest opinion, we might even be doing him a disservice. It's kind of a bit more than that. But anyways, regardless, the reason I'm talking to you about this book is, well, now it seems especially relevant, I guess, with Cyberpunk 2077 and the sequel to Cyberpunk 2077, right? Now it seems kind of like the right time to be talking about stuff like this. in some respect, I suppose. But not just that, it's also another thing that I find interesting here, and that is that so I'm just going to hide this chopper over there. And that is that basically I've really, really struggled to find people talking about the predictions of future, especially accurate ones in science fiction, and how they relate to the overall development of technology worldwide. Here's what I mean in sort of TLDR, don't want to watch the whole video kind of language. Basically, you have certain works of fiction that predict certain either political events or either economic situations and developments or just straight up technological inventions. Flying cars, teleporters, you know, whatever. And then the question is, how much of what we develop as a species and what we create is owed to science fiction and literature? In other words, is science fiction a breeding ground for ideas in which we go, right, well, let me imagine and conjure something brilliant, and then let's try and shift science in the real world to try and work towards that because that seems like a good idea? Generally speaking, that sort of tends to be the thing with science fiction, right? To imagine what is scientifically not possible. Really, Juggernaut, you literally just translated the word. Yes, but here's the thing, like, that's the whole purpose of it. Other social elements where you want to warn against something, and that's exactly what this book is doing, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You also want to make society better with it occasionally, or warn against degradation of certain things in society, so on and so forth. But other than that, this is also like one of its primary purposes, correct? So how much of it actually works? How much of, if a teleporter gets invented in, I don't know, 3 or 4 years, or 50 years, or 150 years, how much of it do we owe to, for example, Star Trek? Beam me up, Scotty, right? How much of it do we owe to Gibson? How much of it do we owe to writers and authors in general? Not something that's really easy to quantify, and as a result, not something that people talk about, but there is something else. This is not the topic of the video. Like, this is something that people don't really talk about, but there is more to this. There is, like, we go even deeper now. What about predictions that aren't so prevalent, aren't so popular, and aren't so mainstream, I guess, right? What about things that are mentioned in science fiction and then not really, don't really have that impact, don't really become that popular, don't really, you know, how do I put this? We know for a fact that they don't really influence much because not many people know about them, and yeah, they don't have the cultural significance that, for example, Star Trek does. I mean, everyone knows Beam Me Up, Scotty, right? Everyone knows flying saucers and flying cars and stuff. That's mainstream. You don't really need to know where it originated, although that's important as well, but you don't really need to know where it exactly originated because it doesn't matter. It's become common knowledge, right? But what about things that happened way before that predict very accurately something and people aren't really aware of, right? Specifically, I want to talk about, well, Gibson's work for one. That's one that I've just read, so it's sort of still fresh in my mind. But there's also another work. And that work, I actually haven't read the entire book. I know parts of it. I've read extracts. I've done some analysis of it, so on and so forth. We've covered it in some at university at some point, and not like lectures, but, you know, like for work and stuff. But I haven't actually read the thing from cover to cover. But I also have the book here with me, and is it in English? I don't think it's in English. No, it's in the original. Well, never mind. Well, here's the thing. Have you heard of an author called Yevgeny Ivanovich Zamyatin? Now, Zamyatin is an interesting character. In fact, a very, very fascinating character. And one of his most, if not his most influential and popular and capital work is We. No, that's, you know, W-E, We. That's the title of a novel. And yeah, you could also make some similar arguments to Gibson about, you know, robots and surveillance culture and all sorts of... Sorry, I'm skipping steps along the way to get to surveillance culture, right? Mass surveillance, Big Brother, and so on and so forth, and then a culture developing around that, and so on and so forth. You could also argue that, yeah, fine, fair enough. However, there's one thing that Zamyatin writes about in one of his works that sort of... I don't think most people are aware of, and I haven't really seen anyone write anything about it in academia. If there is, maybe I just haven't found it, but it's definitely not a commonly considered thing, let's just call it, right? It's definitely not common, it's definitely not out there as public information or whatever. And that is that, ladies and gentlemen, at one point in his life, Zamyatin decided to talk about not just bureaucratic totalitarianisms, surveillance and so forth and so on. No, he decided to talk about nuclear weapons and nuclear reactors and paint me a picture, paint us really, a picture of a Fallout-esque post-apocalyptic world where the reactors and bombs have gone off and, yeah, now we're living in Stalker/Fallout times, right? Well, okay, Juggernaut, why are you so excited about that? Why are you yelling? This, like, when I woke up, I wanted to do this video, and I was thinking about how I do the big reveal, and I decided not to. Instead, I'm going to ask you to go and Google when Zamyatin wrote We. And while you're at it, you can also Google when he lived. What time period? When did he die? Yeah. Yeah, I'm just going to give you a couple of seconds to do it. I'm not going to tell you. But I think it's a lot more impactful when you actually Google it and see the information for yourself than me telling you. So I'm going to just let you know. The video starts here. You can come back to it. I'm going to give you a minute to pause and go check and then come back. All right? Did you see it? Fascinating, right? Huh? Huh? That's what I'm talking about. That blew my freaking mind. And I actually talked to a colleague in university about this, and I'm like, wait, hold on, something like, when we were initially analyzing this, I was like, hold on, what do you mean radiation? He's talking about radiation. Like, we're not talking about some metaphorical radiation, like literal radiation that, like, you know, gamma rays and beta waves and whatever, like nuclear bomb radiation stuff, right? Yeah, he's talking about radiation. But this was written in... Yeah. How exactly are we not freaking out about this? And my colleague said, well, she said basically, I don't know, man, like, yeah, exactly, good point. Like, it's what I'm telling you as well, but, like, it's just, you know, just goes over people's heads, I suppose, because it's, you know... Sorry. Because, you know, this is not really the core of the book, not really the main topic. It's more like I said, bureaucracy and robots and surveillance and so on and so forth. Totalitarianism and so on. But I'm like, freaking hell, man. You know, like, this is pretty big. And you sort of then, once you come across a golden nugget of information like that, when... You see when he was born, when he wrote this, and then, you know, what transpired in World War II, and, you know, now, I guess, with nuclear warheads and so on and so forth, you sort of, I mean, I don't know, maybe if it's your day job, maybe you don't, maybe you only do this if it's your day job, sorry, but if you are curious about literature and you know, you have a passion for these sorts of things, then you start digging a little bit more. Like, it's like a gold miner that, you know, he starts digging in a mine and he finds a little nugget of gold, and you don't stop there, you keep digging, right? Also, sometimes it's okay to stop, but, like, a whole meme thing, but anyways, it doesn't matter. You dig more, it drives you forward, right? The more you find, the more you want to find. It's sort of like, I guess, intellectual greed in some weird sense, perhaps you could call it. But yeah, you get the idea, right? That's sort of the stuff I'm talking about. And you keep exploring and you realize there's more. Not tons, and it's difficult to find, because it's not like there's a list of scientific predictions that came true because of whatever reason. No, but you keep digging and you find things, and now you're even more fascinated, and holy hell, this has been going on for a while. Yeah. Turns out, with the advent of predictions being popular in the sense of science fiction, and you know, more and more predictions happening, turns out that occasionally you get something right. And now, the question is it a case of just getting something right because blind luck? There's an expression in my native language that basically goes, even a blind hen will occasionally find a seed, right, if it just keeps plucking. So, is it that? Is it just a blind hen that got lucky? Or is there a more complicated and more, maybe not detailed, but is there more of a connection to things? Are things more sort of aligned, right? And yeah, I would say that definitely with mainstream concepts and ideas that aren't yet real, it definitely doesn't come down to specifics. It definitely doesn't come down to, oh, because this author, or because Gibson wrote about, I don't know, cyberspace, now computer development is going to go towards cyberspace, even though that's pretty much what happened, especially if you don't take cyberspace literally, which you're not really meant to, quote-unquote, meant to, right? Cyberspace isn't really this literal thing that you... It is in the book. It is a physical, literal... Well, not really physical. It is a thing. And it is expressed through literal space. Even though that space isn't really 3D, and it is just space in your mind, or in the character's mind, it is actual space. Kind of like in Cyberpunk 2077. I mean, it's the whole universe, right? Even though Night City and Cyberpunk 2077 isn't really based off of Gibson's novel, the author that wrote about Night City and the basis that is used for the Cyberpunk story, with the characters and everything, is more than heavily inspired by Gibson. I mean, he started the whole thing. He invented Night City, right? Night City appears for the first time ever in history with Gibson and with the Neuromancer. And I feel like a lot of people are giving credit, maybe not giving credit where it's not due, it's certainly due to other authors that have contributed as well, but I feel like nobody's mentioned Gibson ever since the release of Cyberpunk 2077, and the man created the world you're looking at. Okay, not literally, it goes to the other guy, but he talks about Night City, right? And he talks about corporations, and sure, the corporations have different names, but who cares? It's still the same kind of universe. He talks about cyberspace, he talks about ice, he talks about walls, he talks about human augmentation, and all of those things that you see started with Gibson. And so I'm going to get back to him in a little bit, and he makes some really scary predictions about not just computer development, but also other things like music. There's dubstep in Gibson's novel. Yeah, you might be shocked to learn about that. I certainly was, but there is indeed dubstep in Gibson's novel. I wasn't ready for it either. What can I tell you? I mean, it's funny man, that Gibson character, right? Anyways, yeah, that was Why is he giving me... No, we're going here to pick up the oil. All right, anyways. Game of the background, by the way, is a heavily modded Civ 5, which I've been playing for a long while, as you can see. And it's pretty much just, at this point, just a role-playing kind of run. I've already achieved diplomatic victory. And I've pretty much, the turn after, I've achieved cultural victory as well. So, yeah, it's like... game's over. But for now, let's go back to what I was talking about just a few minutes ago, and that is... how much of this is down to individuals? How much of it is down to just our own imagination? And I think for more common things like flying cars, teleporters, faster means of communication, transport and stuff, it's not just science fiction and individual authors that drive us towards this, it's our needs, right? And that's really, I think, a big thing. And that's really, I think, where things split. Is do we actually need what is in the science fiction novel, or is it just a crazy idea by some wacky individual? I would argue, if you invent nuclear weapons many, 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 many years prior to the invention of actual nuclear weapons, you wouldn't say, well, that's a need of humanity, that's what we really gotta work towards, even though improving weapon systems is pretty much a need, right? It's what we've been doing for the entirety of our existence. It's not exactly something completely revolutionary, but at the same time, it's not quite the same when you take it up to that sort of scale and level. Most weapon improvements have been on a micro level, on the level of the individual soldier and on the level of the individual combatant. For, I would argue, the vast majority of human existence, right? Not to say that there weren't other forms of improvements with, you know, siege engines and stuff like that, but most of them stem from the individual level. Anyways, besides the point, my ADHD brain is sort of going all over the place now. I have like 7 different things I want to talk about and still wrap the video in like 30 minutes. Is the thing, as I already mentioned, I'm going to repeat myself again just to not lose my train of thought. With individual brilliance like that, I don't think we can attribute it to basic things that we need. And teleporters is, again, just one of those things that we don't need, quote-unquote, but we want, right? And I would argue that even a person that's never read any science fiction novel whatsoever could still imagine faster means of transportation. Whether those cars be flying, teleporting, swimming, phasing through objects or whatever doesn't really matter. It's kind of still the, well, maybe not literally the same thing, but it's, you know, we're in the same realm, sort of, right? Well, now, here's the thing. Here's the kicker. What about things like those nukes? What about things that we don't really need? What about that? Well, like, for example, what Juggernaut? That's the thing. Here's where it splits, right? I started talking about this a minute ago. Here's where I think the real crux of the video is. Here's where it diverges from science fiction predicting the future and guessing and maybe sometimes brilliantly figuring out something that, you know, will happen and before anyone ever had the even faintest idea about it. i.e. nuclear weapons, dubstep, and so on and so forth. And on the other hand, where science fiction shapes the future, right? Here's the split. So, on the one hand, when you see these more common things that we all sort of, as a society and as a species, strive towards improving our quality of life in science fiction, or even seeing in science fiction the abuse of such things, for example, I don't know, weaponized, I guess, improvements, teleporting nuclear bombs or whatever, doesn't matter, right? When you see stuff like that, it's nanites and, you know, technology being too advanced, going too far, and you being able to hack people into stopping their hearts or whatever, you know, that sort of thing. Even there, with improvements in medicine and stuff like that, even there you see a sort of general picture where this is the kind of stuff that we're going towards, and then changing our lives and our science and going towards that. That's one thing, but when you see small, super precise things that sort of fall away from the mainstream ideas and fall into, you know, oddities and curiosities that not many people know about, that's individual genius. That's brilliance. That's something truly, truly special. And you could argue, on the one hand, when talking about this, sorry, this other section, you could argue that, oh, well, they just got lucky, right? And I know I already mentioned this, but you could say that, it's just they got lucky, they made a guess and it worked out, and yeah, you know, they picked up a random word or something, and then they picked up a random idea, and lo and behold, that actually came true. It's not big. Sure, I bet there's cases of that as well. There's gotta be something else as well. It happens too often, right? It happens way too often to be just pure chance and something purely random. And really, the whole big thing about cyberpunk and science fiction nowadays in general tends to be that it's quite pessimistic. Think about, I mean, pretty much anything other than Star Trek, right? Okay, not really. There's other things as well. Philip K. Dick used to write some pretty inspiring science fiction works, and some of them were warnings, and some of them were pessimistic outlooks on the future, but some of them were pretty gosh darn interesting as well, right? And kind of optimistic as well. So with that in mind, it's kind of trendy, I guess, and hip to write pessimistic, prophetic warnings of with some sort of dark implications when it comes to science fiction. But it's a whole other thing when you nail it and that's exactly what happens or is about to happen or has happened already. And that's kind of brilliant, right? And you don't really just find that in science fiction that's based around technology. You also find it in dystopian novels, which ultimately kind of deal with the future as well. So there's that element of predicting the future there as well. Really, if you think about it, it's not just cyberpunk, certainly, and it's not just science fiction either that deals with this. Anytime you try and make a prediction about something, you're dealing with the future. Well, no, shit, Juggernaut. I know, hear me out, but there's more to it. Every time you try and warn society about something through literature, you're also dealing with science fiction in a way, right? Because you're predicting the future of what will happen if this continues or this happens, whether economically, culturally, it doesn't matter, right? If it doesn't have to be aliens that come here and do it, it could be just, I don't know, the decline of capitalism or whatever, as silly as books like that tend to be. It doesn't matter, you're still dealing with predicting the future, and ergo fiction. Sometimes it's not based around science, sometimes the basis is more realistic and more grounded in what we already know and have, and in that sense then it is not science fiction. But it deals with, it sort of falls under the same broad genre that doesn't really have a name other than we're predicting the future and warning people against stuff. There are words for that as well. In some respect, you could argue that it's socially active or socially engaged literature as well, but not quite the same. That kind of literature tends to call to action immediately now in the present, right? And you could argue that this is what that sort of literature does. It basically tells you to, right, for example, let's use cyberpunk. Corporations are getting out of hand, they're getting too powerful, stop them now. You could argue that that's the message of cyberpunk. Stop them now before we get to Night City. You could argue that that's one of the takeaways there. Although I would argue with Gibson, it's not about corporations at all. What do you mean? That's the main thing that everyone talks. As soon as something becomes the main thing that everyone talks about, then it is not the point. There are other more important things there to talk about and consider. But anyways, doesn't matter. That may be a bit much for one YouTube video, But I will go there for a brief second, if not more. Steer clear of anything that's way too mainstream and then popular opinion and so on and so forth. There's nothing you can do with that. More often than not, it turns out to be just hocus pocus BS and doesn't really contribute to anything. And sometimes it's just straight up dangerous, but again, a completely different topic for a completely different video, and one that I will probably never make, because it's one of those hot takes, right, that in your heart of hearts you know absolutely to be true, and yet you also at the same time absolutely know that this is not something that you're gonna get a lot of people to agree with you on, right? Yeah, so anywho, regardless of all of those things that I just said, let's go back to this individual brilliance. It's quite something, I would argue, right? It's quite something, and I feel like we don't really respect it, and we don't really nurture it. I mean, respect to Zamyatin died, right? Whether we revere his work now as a genius who predicted nuclear weapons and stuff, or we don't, doesn't really matter at this point. Especially because he doesn't literally talk about nukes falling and being launched from silos and stuff like that. It's a little bit different, but the fact that he mentions radiation to begin with is kind of, you know, in that context, I mean, not just radiation as a thing that exists, but, you know. Anyways, besides the point, it's not just about acknowledging individual contributions or individual brilliance like that. It's more about cherishing it. I get the feeling that nowadays we're just working off of reworks and remakes and so on and so forth. And I don't just mean the Marvel movies and TV shows and stuff like that. I mean, like, within original creative works of art as well, I feel like there's too much just repetition of what has previously been imagined, if that makes sense, right? There's repetition of you see it in cyberpunk. It's a mass-produced thing. It's a mass-produced product now. Started with Philip K. Dick, he took it to its to a length, and he didn't go very far with it. And this is a part of the trilogy, but there is certainly more to be said about the world. And then after him, more was definitely said about the world. It appeared all over the place. And then, you know, especially with like stuff like Blade Runner and so on and so forth, which changed things a lot, but still sort of remain in that general area. But I feel like we don't really strive enough towards rewarding something extra creative and crazy. We tend to sort of stay in the lane of what was already established, and very rarely do we get someone leaping out and going the distance. Here's what I mean. Philip K. Dick dared to imagine the world 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now, in a time where science fiction didn't exist. I mean, the man formed science fiction, right? But the very inventor of the thing that we all love didn't stop with one universe, didn't stop with just recreating the same story about robots from different perspectives, and there's value in that as well, but he didn't stop there. He went 1,000,000 years, 1,000,000,000 years, 100,000,000,000 years forward. He kept going and toying with it, right? Playing with the idea and going from one wild extreme to the next, writing brilliant pieces of work along the way. And I feel like we're missing the Philip K. Dicks of the world, right? And not just within science fiction, but within most scientific endeavors nowadays, right? We tend to sort of stay within the realm of what's familiar and what's grounded within other people's work already. And as someone that works in academia, I can tell you that it's become at this point kind of mandatory to do it, because you can't publish anything unless you back it up and quote it with like a third of your work being a copy of someone else's, ultimately. Not literally just a copy, fair enough. You're still doing original work there, and usually you use other people's work to back you up in your ideas or to argue against their ideas and so on and so forth. That's kind of how the whole writing process in academia and scientific articles and stuff goes. But the problem there is you're still arguing between Pepsi and Coca-Cola, or maybe Fanta and Coca-Cola, if you want to use like two different companies, right? You're still arguing between two different companies. You're still arguing between AMD and NVIDIA, and the owner, the CEOs of both are like cousins, right? You're still within the same dichotomy. You're within the same system. It's difficult, and it's kind of at some points even punished to go beyond, to go around, to think outside of the already established and already familiar dichotomies. And it's something that a couple of professors of my university are sort of trying to battle against in their own fields. That what tends to happen, especially with Anglican and Anglo-centric literature, and not Anglican in the sense of the Anglican church, but like Anglo literature, like, you know, English and American. What tends to happen is we tend to stick to the same things a little bit too often. We keep writing about Shakespeare and Poe and Philip K. Dick, even if you want to do science fiction, and we keep writing about the same people, and there's a billion articles about the same guy. And if you want to try and branch out a little bit, well, now all of a sudden you're lost and you don't have the backup for it, in the sense of other people's hundreds of works that you kind of have to have nowadays. And what ends up happening is you sort of can't do it. You know, you're being held back by this idea that you need to fit within this dichotomy. And credit where credit is due, many professors I know have tried to branch out in different ways, especially those that haven't, they don't really focus and they don't really care about, they don't really care about science fiction and video games and stuff like that, but more traditional works of art and such. What the hell? Oh, sorry, there's music coming from the other room and I got very confused. Anyways, I thought I was hearing the bells toll, right? I was like, that's it, they're taking me away. Anywho, they tried to branch out in different ways. For example, I know one professor that on a particular, what do you call it? Sorry, I'm missing the word, give me a second. Scientific gathering, it's not what the word I'm looking for is, I'm literally translating it from what the name of the event was. It's a conference, right? It's kind of a conference, like of researchers and stuff. So on that particular conference, he said, well, you know what, sod this, I'm gonna go and look at Finnish literature and take things from there and bring it into this sort of dichotomy and system that we have here. And it's crazy because who deals with Finnish literature, especially in a place where it's mostly about English or French literature and that sort, those sort of schools of thought and philosophy and fiction and so on and stuff dominate the field. Well, oh, he's going to branch out and go and do something else. I mean, for political reasons, partially since 2014, but even before that, because of the Soviet Union and everything, Russian philosophy and Eastern works have also not been the most popular in recent years, right? And I mean, you know, you can blame politics all you want, but like even Dostoevsky and Tolstoy and stuff like that, they've even fallen out of favor and of this sort of Western European sort of central system of research that we have and that really kind of dominates the world almost. even they've fallen out of favor, and so bringing them back in now also seems kind of revolutionary, and I guess that's a paradox of its own. But regardless of the fact, that's what I feel like we're kind of missing from science fiction, and from not just science fiction, but in general now, right? That there needs to be more craziness, right? Like more innovation in the sense of just, I don't know, going beyond what is an already established system, predicting the future and forming the future at the same time. Going back to the title of the video, right? Sure, acknowledge personal brilliance, that's important, but not just that. Go beyond that and work on things that are not just remakes, but original, new IPs, new ideas. Stuff that probably won't work, but if it does, oh boy, if it does. And that's sort of when we get to the crux of why I wanted to make this video. And the core of it is that science fiction is something that's really produced utter brilliance at times. Utter brilliance on an individual level, where you have people predicting and warning against very, very specific things that are going to happen or have already happened in the world, right? It's, you have a lot of that. Definitely, undoubtedly, you have a lot of that. But it also does something brilliant in another way, and that is, it dares to dream. It's a breeding ground for silly ideas that probably will never work, and then a surprising number of them do. Right? That's the real sweetness of it. That's the where the nectar is. A surprising number of them do. And it's an interesting field of study, in case you couldn't tell. but more so than just being idle fascination with it, I think it's culturally very important and significant, and on a whole level of civilization, I would say so as well. This video has gone on for way longer than I thought, and I went into some broad statements that don't really mean much, so I apologize for that. I prefer to just stick to specifics, but anyways, tell me what you think about the whole two-way street, I suppose, of or the whole split, I guess, in two directions, not only a two-way street. The whole split in two directions between science fiction predicting and creating the future. Kind of the whole reason why I wanted to make this video, especially among my audience that's more, not many of us, but some of us that are, more sort of interested in just, at the very least, random food for thought like that, where you sort of think about things like that, not necessarily maybe do much with them, but just kind of fascinating to consider and chat about for a little bit. I want to hear from you, especially what you think about the line between the two, and I guess the question I want to leave is, how much of it is random guesswork? How much of it is individual brilliance? And how culturally significant is it? In a good way or a bad way? To give you a kind of a banal example, do you think cyberpunk might give some corporations ideas of just how far they can go with impunity, right? Just because it's a warning doesn't mean it has to be good, right? You can go the opposite direction as well. You can be like, well, because of science fiction, we had some nasty ideas about how society should be run, and there's some people nasty enough to try it, right? You could argue also that, not that that literature bears responsibility for what happens, but, still the kind of, I guess, the idea is there. Yeah, anyways, went a bit off topic by the end, and then video went for longer than it should, but I feel like it's an interesting concept, and I feel like if you think about it, it's one that, kind of leads us away from just mass reproduction and into some stupidity, for sure, but also some potential brilliance at the end of it. And that's what I feel like is really, really important here. And sort of talking in more practical terms, what I mean by that, you know, leap forward and stuff like that, is revolutionizing anything. Narrative in video games, stories, coming up with new stories, coming up with new video game genres, right? Coming up with, and then it happens with indie titles. You get some pretty innovative and crazy stuff, but it almost feels like every time you're sort of doing that, you kind of get punished for it, right? If you come up with an RTS game or a first-person game that's way too innovative, you kind of get punished for it. Although you could also always provide examples to the contrary, and in fact there was one with VR and being, you know, extra realistic and stuff. What was it called? Came out very recently. The name escapes me right now, but you'll know what I mean. The one where it's it looks like a GoPro footage from an actual war zone when you play it, right? That one. I forget the name completely escapes me at this point, but besides the point, you could argue that, you know, but that's the thing. We need more of that, right? Well, not more of that specific thing, not reproducing it, but more crazy ideas like that. Hell, I remember when Half-Life came out, the original, and then Half-Life 2. The amount of technological brilliance and just showcasing that happened in Half-Life 2. I mean, half the game was a bloody engine demonstration for what the engine can do, fair enough, but things that now are considered more or less normal back in the day, like interacting with all the little bits and bobs and glasses and balls and boxes and stuff around the world, and AI chatter and some of the AI behavior, and phew, man, that was revolutionary, all of those things. And then you take a look at Half-Life 2 now, and you sort of think about half of how far we've gone in that sense of revolutionizing game engines and stuff like that, and you think about how long it's been, and yeah, we're kind of plateauing now, aren't we? That's kind of really what I'm afraid of, that we're kind of plateauing now in terms of development. I mean, we've been using the same system for CPUs and GPUs and stuff for God knows how long, and we just keep adding more RAM to it and adding more VRAM, or adding more cores to it and stuff. I don't know, give me a quantum computer or some nonsense, right? It's something. Yes, I know that currently with the infrastructure and everything, they're completely useless for gaming, but you know, like, let's make that leap forward, and that's where I feel like science fiction helps a lot, with those great big leaps forward that you get with crazy ideas and stuff. And that's how you shape and form future. And then you also have people writing about nuclear weapons many, many years before the idea for one ever came about. Okay, to be fair, not quite literal nuclear bombs being dropped from, you know, B-52s and B-16s and so on and so forth, whatever the aircraft was that dropped it. But still, you know, you get the general idea. I also wanted to talk about cyberspace in Philip K. Dick, especially if we consider cyberspace as a not a literal thing, and look at it more metaphorically, look at it more through the lens of how generally you would look at ideas and metaphors and symbols within works of literature and so on and so forth. But I realized that it's going to be probably a bit much for this video and kind of off topic, so I'll leave that for another time. Especially because it's the way you see it in Cyberpunk 2077 is more or less the way it is in Philip K. Dick, except his is not Philip K. Dick, in Gibson. Did I say Philip K. Dick several times? I meant Gibson and Neuromancer, sorry. Except his is a little bit more colourful, which is also another thing I wanted to kind of mention. we sort of tend to equate cyberpunk with everything being gloomy, dark, and grey. It's not grey. It's neon. It's artificial, but it's not grey. And I've mentioned this, I think, in some video that I did of... what was it? I think it was Cyberpunk, wasn't it? Yeah, I think it was Cyberpunk. I mentioned this in some video of Cyberpunk that I've done. Everything's grey in Night City. It's not supposed to be grey. You know, like, it's supposed to be way more colourful. And yeah, you know, with reshade and stuff, you can get it up there. But generally speaking, like, no, it's not grey. Like, post-apocalyptic stuff is grey, like, after the end, right? After the destruction and so on and so forth. You know, that's, well, I have some problems with the term post-apocalyptic as well, because, you know, the apocalypse isn't really destruction, it's unveiling and so on and so forth. But anywho, topics for many different videos. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for watching me and listening to me ramble on and on about this stuff. I hope you found it at least a little bit interesting, maybe learned something new and fascinating today. I will see you all next time. If you have any suggestions for maybe topics when it comes to literature and videos like this, feel free to leave them down in the comments below. I do enjoy rambling on about this sort of stuff, and it just so happens that the internet is big enough and wide enough and popular, not popular, but has enough weird people on it that occasionally some of them also want to listen to me ramble on about stuff like this as well. No, I know, weird, but let's just say that somehow, by some miracle, I even found an audience for stuff like this. Jokes aside, of course, I do appreciate your attention. Thank you very much for watching, and I will see you all next time. Like, subscribe down below if you enjoyed, and stay tuned for the rest of the series, for the rest of the content that I produce on the channel, but also for more videos like this. See you all next time. Have fun, take care, and bye-bye.